Next speaker on now, and that is Dr. Jaydeep, has been the past president of ISAR and the past president of Aspire, the third biggest international organization of infertility specialists. And she'll be taking us through the embryo endometrial crosstalk. This is a very interesting topic which has been discussed, very less understood, how to improve the implantation rates, how to understand that the embryo and endometrium actually talk to each other and release chemical messengers and things, and how do we pick them up rightly and optimize.
Yeah, hi. A very good morning to all of you. So I'm really going to talk on endometrium embryo crosstalk, and it's hard to speak like this when you can't see anyone, but I'm going to try my and do my best. Friends, there are a lot of answers which we have been asking for, and we hardly understand a bit of it. Because when we are putting in good embryos and we are looking at a good endometrium, and why only about 50% of the embryos actually implant? And this implantation is eluding us all the time. We really can't understand. And what we understood was that, yes, you need a good embryo, you need a good endometrium, and that's it. But successful implantation actually is much more than that. It requires a synchronization of the embryo at one end and also the endometrium at the other end. But what is also more important is that we need to have a crosstalk between the two, which is the exact determinant of how implantation will take place. And can you imagine, when you go into the depth of this, there are so many things which you actually find out that it's not that it is a passive structure which is lying there. And it's not only that the embryo is just rolling into the cavity and, you know, finding a good place implanting there. It exactly doesn't really happen like that. It is much, much more complex. It is much more synchronized. It is also depends on the quality of the embryo, which is actually going to then determine how the response of the endometrium is going to come up. And it also depends on the quality of the endometrium to respond to the quality of the embryos. And it's unimaginable how God has actually. So if you see here, the response of the endometrium to a good quality endometrium. But if you see here, that's the response of the endometrium to a poor quality embryo. Now, as we go ahead, I read this beautiful paper from our own India, the ICMR, the National Institute of Research in Reproduction. And it's wonderfully written, War in the Times of Love. And can you imagine that the implantation of the embryo here is going for the initiation of the pregnancy is a battle where the embryo uses, you know, a lot of coercive tactics to force its acceptance by the endometrium. So actually there's a war going on between the endometrium that you see here is the luminal epithelium and the stroma, and that's the endometrium. So a lot of enzymes and biomarkers are actually exuded by the embryo, which brings about the changes in the stroma and the luminal epithelium, where it then goes ahead and opposes and invades the endometrium. So, and it's a very, very well orchestrated classic example of coercion. Now, I'm just going to example, because all this, what we learn from the basic science, we are trying to apply and making our cycles and our pregnancy rates much better. And there is a classic signal of HCG. Now, a day two cell stage embryo actually starts producing HCG. And can you imagine now, this HCG is having direct effects on the endometrium and also is having indirect effects on the corpus luteum. So corpus luteum, we always knew, rescuing the corpus luteum by HCG. But the effects on the endometrium now, it's important for us to understand that this HCG actually is then increasing a lot of mediating particles, which will prepare the endometrium to actually accept this embryo. Now, why this is important? So if you see here, there is an amazing amount of crosstalk which is going on between the embryo, the endometrium, and the ovary. And all this is actually facilitating the implantation. Now, we have understood a lot of things. We have understood that, yes, the embryo has to be largely euploid. We have also understood that the endometrium has to be receptive. A very recent concept which has come up is the biosensor mechanism. So this emerging concept of biosensor is basically what it is, that the response of the endometrium to a euploid or to an aneuploid embryo is going to actually make the changes which will prevent or which will facilitate implantation. And it is a very active crosstalk which is going on between the endometrium and the embryo. Now, we understand the concept of endometrial receptivity. Now, we know that, you know, under estrogen, there is priming of the endometrium, it becomes proliferative, and then once the progesterone comes in, you know, there's a window of opportunity, and that is where the embryo implants. But what we have actually not understood is, or we understand a little bit, is that if this endometrial receptivity prolongs, then there will be many embryos which will actually be implanting. But if they are not really up to the mark, then they are actually going to land up into miscarriages. And that's where a prolonged and unopposed receptive phenotype of the endometrium will lead to miscarriages. And except for the ones which are really very developmentally competent embryos. Now, on the other hand, we have also now understood that if there is a premature decidualization, which happens in premature LH surge and all, now there is that increases the barrier of the endometrium and it actually reduces the likelihood of pregnancy. So there is a concept of receptivity and there is a concept of selectivity, because that selectivity is also important, because this selection, if it starts a little early, again, will have, you know, it will not let many embryos implant. And that's again what is something which we need to understand. So then another important concept, derived competent signals. So here is a nice good embryo trying to implant and has made a lot of nice changes in the stromal cell, which are facilitating the breach in the luminal epithelium and also then facilitating the implantation. And these are based basically on conserved secretions of certain enzymes like serine protease and all. But if a developmentally compromised embryo is there, then this dialogue actually secretes various things much in excessive. Like, I would just give you an example of this serine protease enzyme only, that excess is there. Now, this excess actually leads to aberrant signals. And once these aberrant signals are there, then a proliferation of the cells or decidual cells, tissue breakdown, all this will happen. And then ultimately, this will lead to elimination of this conceptus, because it is actually otherwise also not a good conceptus. So medicine is an iteration of discordant elements, and sickness is a discord of the elements infused into the living body. And this Vinci said long time ago. So now we understand that the disorders of embryogenesis, infertilization, actually lead to infertility, recurrent implantation failure, and also recurrent pregnancy loss. Concentrate right now on the endometrium. Can you imagine any structure in our body will actually, you know, change so much? It radically changes in biology, it radically changes its endocrinology, it changes its structure and function, and not once, it keeps on changing it every month after month after that. And then to study such a structure and assess its functions is also not going to be easy, because there's so many things happening at the same time. Now, there are many factors which actually influence implantation, and we have understood all those. And I'm not going to go into details, but let me just focus a bit on the uterine or endometrial receptivity. Now, the endometrium becomes receptive under the influence of hormones which are coming in from the ovary, where estrogen and progesterone is there. I'm not going to go into details, but we know that there is a nice window of implantation which is there and which lasts between, let's say, day 17 to day 24 for about 2 to 4 days. So it is not a very small window. It is a good window where all the changes which we are really looking at indicating implantation are actually happening. Now this endometrium grows under the influence of estrogen and progesterone. So here I have just put some pictures for you to understand that there's a very clear association between the endometrial growth that is and also the circulating estrogen and progesterone. So here you can see lovely proliferative endometrium, and that's a nice secretory endometrium almost about 5 to 6 days after ovulation. Now, beneath what we see on ultrasound, because most of us ART specialists are only looking at the ultrasound pictures and also maybe the biochemical levels of estradiol and progesterone wherever required. But underneath all these are very complex changes which are happening in the glands and also in the stroma of the endometrium. So if you see here with the estrogen levels, proliferative endometrium, that's about 2 days after ovulation, where you can see the secretory changes in the endometrium, and that's about 5 days after ovulation where the endometrium has become absolutely homogeneous. But look at the stroma here. That's the stroma in early proliferative, late proliferative, and the secretory, where the stromal changes are and the glandular changes are quite awesome in receiving the embryo. Now, how do we really assess the endometrium on ultrasound? So here's a beautiful periovulatory trilaminar picture of the endometrium. So what am I going to see here? That's, you need to see it in a sagittal section first. You look at the endometrium and all, then the endometrium, then the junctional zone, and what we normally call here the central. Then the outer hyperechoic line is zone 2, in zone 3, and in between is zone 2. And around the hyperechoic line, the 2 millimeters area is zone 4. Have the blood supply coming from the uterines to the arcuate to the radial, and then the basal and the spiral arterioles, which are actually going in to the endometrium. Now, slowly and slowly, when the endometrium grows, the blood supply also opens up, and we have the maximum blood supply into the reproductive tract during the periovulatory period. So we study the endometrium not only on its thickness, we also study the pattern, the morphology, which you can see here, a nice triple line leaf pattern will be a type A endometrium, where you can't really delineate the central line, and it's a little more hyperechoic or homogeneous is type B, and this one is a little irregular and totally homogeneous hyperechoic is type C, and the pregnancy rates also will go down from here to here accordingly. So the pattern of the endometrium is also quite important, and the similarly is the blood supply. So if you have a blood supply in the periovulatory period which is not there at all, then the chances of pregnancy are going to be a little. And here we see that in the type 2, you have blood supply, or the when you do the power Doppler, that it's coming into at least zone 2 and 3. But here what we see is that it's a very nicely vascularized endometrium, and this is probably optimum for the implantation according to us, what we see when we don't understand all the other biochemical things, that this is type 1 endometrium which will facilitate. So today, I'm just going to introduce to you a new scoring, multimodal scoring system which has come in, which is based on, we initially used to follow the Applebaum's criteria, but today we can do this system where it's based on endometrial thickness, where optimum 14 millimeters, And if you have something between 9 to 14 millimeters there, you will have will give 3 points. Type A endometrium is good. Then peristalsis, if it is seen about 1 to 3 per minute, is good. Subendometrial blood flow, if it is type 1, whereas a well-vascularized endometrium is also good. And similarly, you could, if you can't do the thickness, you do the endometrial volume if it is more than 4. And the vascular flow indices, they can all be combined to give a score. And if the score is more than 14, it is a good endometrium to facilitate implantation. Now, all over the world, there has been no consensus on thin endometrium. People have their own definitions. But generally, less than 7 is something which we actually take. Or may, if it is more than 14, we say that this is not a very good endometrium for implantation. And that is where, even when you look at the pregnancies, the maximum pregnancies fall in between this thickness. But as the endometrium grows thicker than 14 millimeters, or the patterns are not as congenial, then the pregnancy rates fall. But here was this paper which actually was suggesting that a lone endometrial thickness does not have any value. So we should not really discriminate or, you know, cancel embryo transfers just based on the endometrial thickness, because pregnancies do happen in thinner endometrium also, where if you see here, though they are lower, if the endometrial thickness is less than 7, but still up to 23% of pregnancies will happen. So it all has to be individualized. So supposing if you're not able to improve the endometrium beyond a point, do not push the patient to surrogacy if it is between 5 to 7 millimeters and good morphology with good blood flow, then pregnancy embryo transfer can be tried. Another very important thing which I actually had been noticing for a long, long time, years, but never published it. And when I saw this publication from Robert Casper from Canada, it just says that there is compaction of the endometrium once, you know, it's transitioning from proliferative to secretory. And if this compaction is more than 10%, then chances of pregnancy are much higher. And this is something, again, when we are looking, when we are following up, we can look into. Now, we have understood the endometrium. We have understood the receptivity and the selectivity problems. And we now know that there are many factors which could affect the endometrial receptivity. And we also understand that recurrent implantation failures can happen, though we still do not have the consensus on the definition. The latest definition which has come up is failure of clinical pregnancy after transfer of at least 4 good embryos in at least 3 fresh or frozen IVF cycles in a woman who is under the age of 40, because age also plays a great role in the euploidy of the embryos. I would like to now bring you a notice to this landmark paper of in Lancet way back in 1975. And what did it say? That almost about 78% of all conceptions were lost before birth. Now, why did we lose all those? And this brought in the concept of or euploidy. And we need to understand that there is not only the endometrium or not only a good looking embryo, there are many more things which actually are looking or helping or facilitating implantation. So wherever we are having, you know, recurrent implantation failures, we must look into the genetics of either the parental or the embryos. So parental karyotype is one area which, and then the other is the euploidy of the embryos. So we all thought that PGS or PGTA, what is it called today, is the answer. And we started doing transfer of only euploid embryos, thinking that once we are putting in a euploid embryo in a good endometrium, so we're going to get 100% pregnancy rates. Unfortunately, that did not happen. Because in spite of transferring euploid embryos, the clinical pregnancy rates were just to the tune of 50%. And there were many other factors which needed to be understood and concerned, because there were many problems with PGTA, because we don't have something called a normal embryo. Embryos also have many problems like mosaicism. We have totally abnormal embryos. We have normal mosaic embryos, and we can also have mosaic embryos. And each one will now, and you understand, will put in different signals to the endometrium, and then the endometrium is going to respond very differently. So we came back 360 degrees and we said, oh, implantation failure. We need to now focus from the embryo again back to the endometrium. So what did we start doing? We started doing endometrial receptivity assays. So once we did endometrial receptivity assay, we thought, oh, now that's an answer, because there is almost about 238 genes which are expressed in a receptive endometrium. And if we have a receptive endometrium, our job is done. So error came into play. But later on, we realized that error also does not really look into the pathological conditions or the histopathology, because error is done when this endometrial biopsy which you send is dissolved, and only the molecular dating analysis is done. So after error, what happened? So we now started analyzing it a little differently, and what we realized was that the results of a particular this study which I'm quote is that when these good embryos in frozen transfer was done, so they actually did not, only about 39% ongoing pregnancy rate was there where adjustment was done according to the error. And this, along with when you study in a normal pregnancy rate, there was just about 35%. So there was no significant difference between the personalized adjusted frozen embryo transfer in patients who were where error was done, and in a normal transfer which you do in a normal circumstances. So no benefit was actually found in implantation or pregnancy rates. So the next important thing was that is receptivity, and there's another thing which we call as endometriosis. A lot of times which I found was that when you are, you know, have done a transfer and the patient comes back to you on the day of the beta HCG test, and when you do a scan, you see a semi-secretory or a early secretory endometrium, or maybe just proliferative endometrium. So we need to now understand that once the endometrium is growing, so, or is proliferative, it cannot proliferate and differentiate at the same time. So if it is proliferating, it cannot differentiate. And once it stops, then the differentiation starts. And we have to understand that if it does not differentiate, then the implantation or the what we call as apposition or invasion of the blastocyst is not going to take place. And there are many, again, factors which actually create problems as far as implantation is concerned in the endometrium, normally generally categorized as growth disorders of the endometrium or inflammatory lesions which you may see, or autoimmune lesions, or maybe sometimes, you know, retained products of conception. And also tuberculosis is one of the major issues, but most of the time tuberculosis is also causing inflammation and infection. So what we understood was that when you do a biopsy, now you have a stromal component of the endometrium and you have the glandular component of the endometrium. Most of the times there is uncoupling of the stromal and glandular development. So what that, the stroma has gone ahead and differentiated, but the glandular development, but you giving it to any patient, but in this particular patient, these are not matching, and this is what we call as the glandular development arrest, and this is where no pregnancy is going to happen. Now let's come to the another aspect, which is what we call as the junctional zone. So if you see this ultrasound picture here, that's the endometrium and that's the myometrium, And this interface of the endo with the myometrium is what we call as junctional zone. Now, it has been seen that in recurrent implantation failure cases, this junctional zone is much thicker. Normal should be between 2 to 8 millimeters, but in RIF patients, it will be much, much larger, maybe 12, 14 or so on. Then others may have some anatomical interventions, which again will have a effect on implantation. And here you can have, like, the known ones we have is submucous fibroids or larger fibroids. Then here you can see adenomyosis, which is developing, T-shaped cavity, septum, then Asherman's and chronic endometritis all can have effects on the implantation. So that's why hysteroscopy in these subfertile cases and hysteroscopic resection is of the problems, especially submucous fibroids and intramural fibroids, which are more than 50% in the cavity, are really, really important. Go ahead. And then what about polyps? Polyps, we normally are very controversial again, because polyps are something where we must be looking at the location and the size. And again, generally, there is no consensus. The list is there that if it is more than 1 centimeter, it should be removed. But I would go ahead and say that if it is placed somewhere like this here, which is called as a point of maximal implantation potential, where the two lines from the both the cornua meet in the cavity, then this, that's where most of the pregnancies implant, it should be removed. What about hydrosalpinges? Hydrosalpinges, again, there is no doubt that hydrosalpinges affect fertility, and we should be removing them, and they affect in many different ways. But when we do salpingectomy, if you're doing a bilateral salpingectomy, it has been seen that the ovarian. So if you have a unilateral hydrosalpings, it's okay to remove. But if it is a bilateral hydrosalpings, then maybe you need to understand either clipping, or we need to save the tubal arteries so that the ovarian reserve are compromised. And this is something very important aspect which needs to be considered. So that's why a fertility enhancing endoscopic surgeon is a requirement of a mandate clinic. Let's come to some other kinds of infections. Again, it has been seen that, you know, a lot of infections, especially sometimes you may not find, if you see a hysteroscopic picture of micropolyps or hyperemia or, you know, stromal edema, these need to be considered. Now, the latest on the block which is coming up is endometrial microbiota, and it has been seen that there is a different kind of colonization of lactobacillus in the vagina, in the cervix, and also in the endometrium. So we need to understand this microbiota better, especially the latest studies have come up where certain kinds of microbes are more common or more detectable in recurrent implantation failure cases. So this might throw a very different light in how we are actually going to now treat or, you know, have protocols for recurrent implantation failures. Then the Apler syndrome, I'm not going to go into much details, but everyone knows that it has its effects, and a lot of therapies have come up, you know, in treating all these thrombotic and other problems. But cold water is something which we need to understand. So a lot of these immunological therapies, like especially, you know, the IVIG, the LIT therapy, the GCSF, and the latest on the block is tacrolimus, which is an immunosuppressive drug. Which has been tried in RIF cases where it is supposed to improve the implantation by almost about 45%. And in all these cases, about 60% of them have had a live birth. But as a new kid on the block, we need to have larger studies. IVIG or intravenous immunoglobulins, though they're very, very expensive, but this particular study in 2018, so they say is that yes, implantation rates or in the clinical pregnancy rates was better in the cases where IVIG has been used. Now, lid therapy or transferring of peripheral blood mononuclear cells, again, very controversial. But what again has come up is that if you really understand the HCG, so HCG prime peripheral blood mononuclear cells probably will help in implanting better. The scratch, the endometrial scratch we have been talking about, time immemorial, and very late said that, you know, endometrial scratch and maybe HCG kickstarting were the two important things which the Cochrane review also said does help. But when you micro dissect this, now the few latest studies have come up and they say that in normal good young in patients, subfertile patients, endometrial scratch has actually no value. But it seems to have some positive effect on the clinical pregnancy rates in patients who have had two or three failures of IVF. So we are now considering, and this latest study which has come up, it concludes that it should not be offered to everyone. And if you're doing it also, the patient has to be made aware. And yes, a subset of patients with previous failures are the one whom it might, again, you know, larger studies might be tried. Thin endometrium has always been. Now, what works in thin endometrium? I really don't know what works. Doesn't really work. Sildenafil doesn't work. We know that GCSF does improve the thickness a little bit, but it has not translated into clinical pregnancy rates. And I really don't know what to offer, but what we have understood is that yes, unless and until we have bigger, larger RCTs, especially in your own country, we should be doing these studies, because all these random cases keep on coming from, you know, everyone. But unless and until RCT is done, we will never be able to say what really works. And the next is the PRP, which I just showed you the video. Now, instillation of platelet-rich plasma doesn't really give any, you know, good effect. But then we said, okay, subendometrial instillation of the platelet-rich plasma might, you know, help. So it was found that, you know, it was effective to improve the endometrial growth. And in some randomized controlled trials, it has said that it improves the pregnancy outcome also. But largely, we need much more than this. Then I come to kickstarting with HCG. I hope you remember in my initial slides where I said that the embryo day, two cell embryo starts producing HCG, which plays a very crucial role in implantation. So what people tried, that they started instilling HCG into the intrauterine cavity before embryo transfer, and it improved the pregnancy rates. So today what we have understood now is what the latest reports say, that yes, instillation of HCG does improve the pregnancy rate, but only to cleavage stage embryos. And this is not holding true for blastocyst. Now, I logically also understand this, because what we understand is that a two-cell embryo is producing HCG, and the changes which bring in another 24 or 48 hours are the ones where when you instill HCG and put in a cleavage stage embryo, it just takes on from there. But in the blastocyst, it may be a bit too late, and that's why it has not shown that many effective results. Lastly, I'm going to come to the effects of controlled ovarian stimulation. We all understand this, and that is why we actually shifted to frozen embryo transfers, because we understand that our ovarian stimulation protocols or little hyperstimulation or supraphysiological estradiol levels do have an effect on the microenvironment and the endometrial receptivity. And that holds true for analogs, for antagonists, and also for gonadotropins. which will be. The lessons we have learned are that controlled ovarian stimulation actually complicates the endocrinology of the endometrium, especially the luteal phase. The endometrium is subject to, you know, a lot of microenvironmental changes, and that's where we actually started adopting milder stimulation protocols and freeze all technology for and protocols for frozen embryo cycles. So and everyone started saying that yes, frozen cycles have better results than fresh. Now we have come much further than that. And today, this is again a latest study from March 2020 only, which I'm trying to now quote and say that it's a large multicentric trial, and which compared, you know, pregnancy outcomes of fresh embryo transfer to frozen embryo transfer in young patients. So what they came out and said that there was no significant difference in live birth rate between fresh and frozen embryo transfer in young women. So they then went on to microanalyze it, and they said that yes, there are factors which may affect the outcome of frozen embryo or fresh embryo transfer. And what are those? In young women, age, especially age, is one which definitely does affect, and we know that. But there are three independent predictors which ultimately identify the main factors which affect the life of ovulatory young women. And what is that? Infertility duration. So they had a cutoff of about 4.5 years in this study. Endometrial thickness. Again, they had a cutoff of about 0.89. And the number of embryos transferred, they transferred to, but so they all have an effect. So we again now have to understand that the frozen embryo transfer also has a subset place only. So we should not refrain from doing frozen fresh transfers in young, normally ovulating patients. And in fact, I was reading, I haven't put it in this particular presentation, but there is a comparison where they have done a comparison between the number of eggs, age, and also fresh and frozen transfers. And they have seen that in wherever young patients where the eggs are less than 11, fresh embryo transfers have definitely much better results. And the ones who have frozen embryo transfers, they would do anyway better either with fresh or frozen. The same group of patients had better results with frozen embryo transfer also. So that again tells us that yes, there are many other factors which define. Is there any difference in the preparation methods? I would quickly go through it between natural, modified, HRT or stimulated cycles. And so I want to understand that you may keep on doing, you know, embryo transfers for a patient and have no pregnancy, and one day you might have an ectopic pregnancy. So that definitely suggests that there is something in the endometrium which actively may be blocking implantation in some cases. And so we need to really understand the endometrium in a much better way. Now, about the drugs, we have estrogen. I don't think there's any controversy about estrogen, because whichever way you may give, if the endometrium is going to grow, it is going to grow. And there is not much difference as far as oral, vaginal or parenteral or transdermal route of estrogen is concerned. But there are definite concerns about progesterone. The route of administration, the serum transfer, because estrogen actually expresses progesterone receptors in the endometrium. So, and these, the progesterone downregulates the estrogen receptors, then only implantation can actually happen. And we understand, especially in our endometriosis cases, where we know that there is progesterone resistance. And this progesterone resistance actually, you know, shifts the receptor balance, and that's where you can have an anti-implantation effect in endometriosis cases. And that's why suppressing it with GnRH agonist and or maybe surgically treating the disease, the implantation rates do improve. Generally speaking, about, you know, implementation and administration, there is a lot more which needs to be done, and I feel that we need a lot of studies still, especially now with oral progesterones coming up. We have to make cycles more friendly. In the last two slides, tell you like how statistics works. In the same year, we've had this publication which says that when you compare natural cycle with ovarian stimulation with gonadotropins or clomiphene, not much difference, which seems to, you know, enhance the pregnancy rates by gonadotropin stimulation or by HRT as compared to natural cycle. Wherever on the other side, a large prospective analysis actually shows you that pregnancy rate. So what I'm trying to say is that we have to keep on doing some research, and we have to keep on statistics will answer a few questions, but statistics sometimes does not answer a lot of questions. Thus, how you analyze is also important. So if you've seen the pregnancy rates have not really improved or there's not much difference, but if you see here now where it says that HRT FET cycles, when you compare to fresh embryo transfer, there is 1.7-fold higher miscarriage rate. So again, now there is a lot more which we need to understand. Again, repeated in RIF cases, you know, the transcriptomic analysis suggested that natural cycles, HRT cycles. So we have to now understand and time our embryo transfers, or maybe sort of streamline our thoughts into understanding and putting forward to the patient in a much better way. So now these are just my last slide on embryo transfer timing with HRT. So we normally used to do a clinical practice, HCG trigger, pick up, and then day 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we would aim at doing a frozen transfer or an HRT cycle where either on the fourth day or on the same day as day 3. But if you do one day shorter or one day more, then the pregnancy rates are much lower. Now, the clinical practice suggesting here is the one which I showed you in the previous cycle. But if you're looking at natural cycles or modified cycles, this is the day of HCG trigger is the day of HCG trigger in a normal cycle. And then you follow accordingly. Or if you're following LH surge, then LH surge happens about 24 hours before ovulation. So you follow accordingly. So I think I have tried to give you enough insight into understanding what goes wrong. I may not have any solutions, but I am certainly admiring the problem. Thank you so much for, you know, being there with me. And I hope together we will sort out the rest also.